All right, I'm going to call to order the regular business meeting of the Board of Education for Monday, October 27th, to order. If I could ask everyone to please stand and recite the Pledge of Allegiance. We will then open the floor for public comment. I'd like to just remind everybody that we want to limit individual comments to 3 minutes or less, please. We'll approve the consent vote agenda, have updates from program and personnel, facilities and finance. Anything on property, Steve?
No, sir.
Okay. See it all? Nothing? School board?
Nope.
Okay. And then we'll be done. All right. Anything else? Okay. Let's start out with our education presentation.
Rita.
I'm very pleased to announce tonight that we have an exciting student activities presentation facilitated by Deborah Beagle, Student Activities Director at Vernon Hills High School, and Jennifer Ulick, Student Activities Director at Libertyville High School.
Thanks so much for having us tonight. This is so uncustomary for me to be behind a podium, so I'll apologize up front. I may just take the microphone off and talk over there. We would really like to thank you for letting us present tonight. It's been a while since we presented on student activities, and we're very excited to update you tonight on some things that have been happening at both schools as it relates to collecting data and tracking students that are in student activities. So with that, let's roll a video, and then we'll come back to the mic.
For the last 20 years, more than 100 peer-reviewed, rigorous academic studies have shown that engagement in student activities increases student performance in a wide variety of ways. The studies can be found in highly respected publications. They analyze longitudinal data sets and apply rigorous statistical controls, which simply means that they follow students over time as they move from middle school through high school and on into college and careers. The studies also compare students in similar ethnic, geographic, and socioeconomic groups as if they were identical twins. So, one is in the marching band, the other is not. One is in the chess club, the other is not. One plays football, the other does not. In one study after another, the research shows that when X equals student activities, performance follows.
So now that we have research out there that shows how important the involvement is for our students and how it impacts their productivity and their success at school, we are able to now do the same thing at Libertyville High School and Vernon Hills High School because there are programs that we have found through our IDSA organization and through some of our professional development with the CATA organization. There's technology out there that we can now tap into to track data and track what our kids are involved in, and then we can make decisions based on data, similar to how we do things in academics.
So then looking at that data, you can say the argument is kind of the same old question, like what came first, the chicken or the egg? And the argument can be, okay, are just better students involved in the first place? So they're just good kids, so they're involved. And then there's the other side, is that we're saying, it's okay, student activities help kids. So, but which is it? There, the argument is, you know, is it the chicken before the egg? And the answer is actually yes. It is for both situations. So with being able to track information with the five-star student program, we can now find those uninvolved students and help them become more successful. And here's a little quick video on that.
Oops.
Here's the result of a simple but powerful equation that emerges when students get involved in a school-sponsored, adult-supervised, student-driven activity. Minneapolis-based Search Institute calls this the equation for human thriving, and research pioneered by Dr. Peter Benson has shown that when a young person discovers their spark, the thing that lights them up, their talent, interest, and passion, and when they can build relationships with three significant adults who are not their parents, those champions can connect the student with opportunities that allow them to thrive. The student activities equation and the human thriving equation follow the same formula, and when you do the math, the results speak for themselves.
So Debbie and I always talk about how wonderful it is to be an activities director in our district because our kids participate. We are so fortunate that so many of our kids are in sports or fine arts or activities, but what really does that look like? Do we have a number on what kids are involved in? So what we did, we found a program called Five Star Students, and it's a data program that tracks what kids are involved in. So we can upload all of our information in terms of what kids are participating in activities, what activities they participate in, what athletics, what fine arts. We can also track kids as it relates to what sort of events they participate in. So are they going to dances? Are they doing the canned food drive? Are they doing a lock-in? And those sorts of things. So when we found this program, we did a summer curriculum project in 2013. We got an innovation grant for scanners, because what we can do with the scanners is scan kids' IDs, and that puts data into the program. And then we have staff volunteers, as well as our advisors, inputting information into the data program. So with that, we want to unveil some information that we have for you.
Okay, so how many students did we reach last year at Vernon Hills and Libertyville? So now, one of the things that we did a little different is, this is, again, our first time running the program. So at Vernon Hills, I entered all the student activity data, so we have 46 clubs, so we made sure that all the advisors got that information. And then I had a staff member that was working on some educational classes, entered in the fine arts data. We didn't want it to be one more thing that somebody else had to do at that point, because we wanted to see, okay, what is this data going to show? Is it going to be something that we're going to use? And then I also had some help with Paul Bretner in terms of entering the athletics. So the Vernon Hills data has all three areas inputted. So the data that we have, that we collected, which is very amazing, is that in at least one activity, we have 80% of our students. And participating in two or more activities, we have about 63%. So we know that there's going to be some outliers in that data. We know that there's some students that may be participating in something outside of, you know, the school. They're scouts, or they're equestrian, or figure skating, or something like that. But for the most part, that's first time we've ever been able to say that. And we're not counting students twice. We're not saying, hey, here's athletics. If they're in athletics or in fine arts, we've counted that student as once. Versus doubling that data, because we have this program to do that for us. Then moving on, let Jen report at Libertyville.
So getting back to what Debbie spoke of, we only track student activities at Libertyville, so that those are only students that are in our clubs, of which we have 56 clubs. So as you can see, 62% of our students are participating in at least one club, and 35% are participating in two or more of those. So I'm really excited to enter our fine arts and athletic information this year to see how those numbers change.
All right, then of course the math person in me started getting a little crazy with the data. I really could spend hours with this program. But so I'm looking at this, I'm like, okay, well now I'm gonna break it down per class and then per gender and like all these different things. Now compare it to their grade point average, and then how do I find the students that are not involved in anything? How do we get them in? And you know, we sometimes will kind of recruit kids to be involved in assemblies, but we're like, hey, if you wanna be in the assembly, you have to be getting good grades. And I've noticed that when I'm reaching out to them and saying, hey, you know, if you really want to be a part of this, you need to be passing your academic classes, and I can't be pulling you out of class. You've got to be doing, you know, your academic work. And you notice, like the video said, you notice that these students have then that spark, something to motivate them. You know, and like the video said, it's not necessarily their parents, it's somebody else. So we really strongly believe, okay, well, now where are we at? Who do we market? And as student activities director, we're like, we got to get those freshmen involved right when they get in the door. And so this I found very interesting, because I'm like, okay, which class is, you know, the most uninvolved class? And then tracking it from year after year, will it be a, will it be consistent? Will it always be the sophomore class is at the lower involved class, or is it the freshman because they're not, you know, they're a little hesitant to get involved? So the data that we found, and again, this is at Vernon Hills for all activities, fine arts, and athletics combined. And I was actually surprised that our least involved class was our senior class. Now the argument can be made, okay, some of those seniors are leaving for work, they're, you know, saving money for college. Also, but you can look at that as saying, okay, athletics becomes more selective by senior year. So maybe now, as activity directors, when we make that database decision making, well, maybe now we recruit the seniors again saying, hey, there's the Outdoor Adventure Club, there's Interactive Service Club. So maybe some of the competitive clubs are set, but we can still recruit those seniors to get them involved, or even look to the seniors and say, this program also allows us to figure out which seniors are not involved, and we can go to them and target and say, hey, well, what do you want to do? What things do you want to be involved in?
So again, looking at the Libertyville data, and again, this is just for clubs that students are involved in. If you take a look at the percentage of kids involved in one activity, it's kind of cool to see that it increases each year. But again, we see a little bit of a drop when they become seniors, and Debbie was referring to the fact that sometimes that, you know, might be because of other obligations and things that kids are involved in. So it'll be really interesting to compare, like you had said, some longitudinal data year after year to see how these numbers change and think about what things impact the change in those numbers and in the data.
All right, so just taking a quick glimpse at the five-star student, it's obviously a very complex program. We can get a lot of data from it. It also has an app, so on our phones or our iPads, we can scan students in at different events. So I just did a few screenshots of my phone, and just to show you, okay, so if I go to Vernon Hills, and I scroll through the list of names, and I picked on Natalie because she's here, and she said it was okay. So if I clicked on Natalie, and then I selected the activities that she's involved in, it's got the activities she's involved in the 14-15 school year, what she was involved in last year, and so according to research, your guaranteed success rate. Woo, Natalie! but we can also check to see what events Natalie has attended. So Natalie has been at the kickoff dance, homecoming dance, powder puff, etc. So then we can look to again, export this data and see what they're involved in and target the uninvolved student from there.
Five Star Students was developed as a reward system for students, really getting kids involved and giving them points for the things that they're involved in. What Debbie and I like about the program is it also identifies kids that are not involved. So we really want to take a look at that down the road and see, you know, how we can reach out to those kids that are not involved.
And then one other thing that we've taken from Five Star is that in the past we've always tracked eligibility for competitions. IHSA obviously requires that for students to compete. But now that the research is saying, hey, there's champions, that these that students are really impacted by those three champions. Well, then if they're involved students, one of those champions is possibly their advisor, their coach, or their fine arts director. So with eligibility, one of the things that we are working on right now is running an eligibility report, and it's really just informative. Because a student may not be concerned that they're not passing their math class, but if they go to the ping pong club or they go to their anime club and their advisor's like, hey, what's going on in math? Do you want some help? You know, we've got some NHS tutors. You can come up and, you know, sit with me. I can help you out. So now you've got just another response to intervention for students to help them, you know, reach their goals.
So with that, we look forward to giving you another update when we have another year's worth of data. So thank you very much. And at this time, we'd love to hear from our students and some of your experiences, maybe an update on student activities, and maybe how you've been impacted by activities, athletics, fine arts.
So I thought it was fitting that since I was a model, I'd talk about the champions in my life. And what I thought they really hit home was like, I think the champions are really important, especially in like my life and like all the other students as well. And I think I want to highlight like the amazing faculty we have in Vernon Hills, and I'm sure it's the same thing at Libertyville, because without them, I don't think I'd be so involved as I am now. Because I'll start with fine arts. Like I started off my freshman year like with Mr. Lucina, and then with Mr. Heath, and with Mr. Lucina, he introduced me to playing the viola as well. Aside from my primary instrument, the violin. And this year, I made IMEA, which is like a district orchestra. So it was like their push. I really look up to them because I plan on continuing playing in an orchestra when I'm in college and beyond college, because I really enjoy it now. And with athletics, I look up to Mr. DeLuca, he's a driver's ed teacher and the soccer coach. And he assisted me in attaining a scholarship when I go to college to play soccer. I have yet to decide if I want to. With academics, Mrs. Ballinger, she assisted me. She provided so much help. She helped me with college apps. She pushed me to join the math team, although I didn't have time, unfortunately. But she was very assisting with all that. And for clubs, I chose student council with Mrs. Beagle and Ms. Tracy. Because sophomore year, I tried to plan an event, and they thought that it'd be fitting for me to be in student council. And never in a million years, if you were to ask me my freshman or sophomore year, would I think I'd be in student council, executive board, my junior and senior year. And I think it's, like, I truly look up to all of these people, because I don't think I'd be where I am sitting right now if it weren't for those people, and I'm so grateful for them. So I think this is an amazing program that they have to track the students and those students that aren't as involved. It's a great way to push them to do something else, because I think it's so beneficial to be involved in the school, and it just really helps in the future. So.
Okay, so I'll be speaking for Libertyville. So basically what I was asked to talk about is the role of participation in student activities and how that plays a role into their success in high school and also in college. So what I believe is that service, sports, academics, and fine arts, they all contribute to two main things, and that's leadership and collaboration. And so whether you're a team captain, or whether you're on executive board like Natalie, or you're just like a leader of a group, or even just like a member, you understand how to work with others, and you're able to efficiently organize like your responsibilities, you can reach out to the community, and you can communicate with others like a lot more effectively. So for an example of this, I participate as a lead in the Relay for Life event, which is in April, and we're like just doing planning right now. But we would like to work with like Cat TV to maybe produce some more videos to be able to get the word out to the rest of the students, and to be able to just promote and produce like a lot of people who would love to like get involved. And then we also work with National Honor Society to recruit volunteers. So in that respect, we can get teams, we can get other volunteers who would help as like on the planning committee and a lot of things like that. And then we also work with local businesses to help support the event. So with that, you get a lot of collaboration between clubs within the school, but then also in the community. And that's what you need in the future, like for getting a job, for being in college. Like those are all like the things that just basically are like a part in like what people look for when they're interviewing with you. So.
Any questions?
I have one comment and one question. So, first of all, I'd just like to say thanks to you and all of our faculty and staff colleagues for all the extra work that you do to make these programs so successful? I mean, I know we frankly have a tendency to just blow it out on our academic numbers that we track all the time, but I really think it's a lot of the things we do in these extracurricular programs that make our students as articulate as these guys are, as mature as they are. And, you know, I know from my own firsthand experience, obviously through my own kids and their friends and the others I've met through the community, it never ceases to amaze me the kind of young people we're sending to these college campuses, how well prepared they are. Again, not just academically, but really to be the leaders on campus that I think a lot of other people aspire to. So I think the programs you guys run are just absolutely fantastic. And again, I just want to say thanks to you and all your colleagues. My one quick question is, where did the inspiration behind this program come from? And what made you take this on as a project? And
we actually, Jen and I have taken professional development to the CATA conference, which rotates between, it's the California Association of Directors of Activities, which is noted as the top program in the country. So when we've gone to that conference, this is where the five star, it's actually a program based out of California. And both of us being on the state organization here at IDSA, we're like, you know what, this is pretty cool. Let's bring it back to Illinois. So the two of us combined with some other schools around the area, we're like, let's try this. And then since then, we have a lot of the schools, it's actually growing. Originally it started out with just a few of us just close by that were marketing or trying the program out. But that's where it really came from, was that conference, and then bringing it to the Illinois Directors of Student Activities. And with Jen and I both being on the exec board, it's nice to be able to then bring it to Illinois and share it. And we help organize the state conference. And we actually had the people who run this company come out and present at our conference in Illinois. And they've been great out here. And they've also, their support's been great because it's a little different. Like Jen said, originally in California, they had a lot of hard time supporting their activities. And so it was also as a rewards program. So they've also kind of tailored the program a little bit to fit Illinois schools a little bit better.
Yeah, that's great. I especially appreciate
that. Yeah, I think the only thing to add is I think our particular interest was always how to get kids involved. Like, we can hire great advisors and we can plan really cool events, but is that what is getting kids involved? And so hopefully by tracking things, we can really take a look at what's motivating kids. And this five-star program is used in a lot of schools that have, like you said, problems with activities and kids are not involved, so it's rewarding kids for their involvement, which we don't really have a problem of kids getting involved, but what about those kids that aren't involved? Because there is a small number out there, so can we then target that population? So,
yeah, and I think that's one of the neatest parts about this. I mean, I don't know that we've ever tapped into that in this way, so I applaud that effort.
Yeah, that was like Jen said, our key thing is finding those students, and then especially with knowing all the research that we've learned behind student activities, like, okay, if students have these champions, and I know that we have, like these guys said, we have advisors that have kind of taken one of those students under their wing that wasn't involved and showed that student, and they turned around and kind of become successful, and that's, you know, extremely motivating to, you know, help a student become more successful.
I'd like to piggyback on something Dr. Grudy said when preparing our kids for college, and when these students go away as a freshman in college, they're away from home for the first time. The research also shows similar, impact at the college level, that the more the students are involved in activities and things, not only academically, but the extracurricular types of things, that the better they do, and especially as they're going away from home for the first time, and it helps them acclimate to that environment. And I think this program sends our kids away very comfortable working in programs, dealing with, you know, meeting new people and really getting involved in things that they may not have thought of before, but will only go to help, you know, become the leaders at those institutions as they go out in the world.
And I do, go ahead, Alex.
The only thing I'd say is it's nice that you want to draw kids in, but as your data matures, I'd also look outreach, perhaps, see what's drawing kids out to outside activities and start to understand those. I've seen several examples where a passion's out there, and instead of drawing them in, you may want to push them out. And just something to think about over the next several years as your data matures.
I just had a question real quick, too. As you are compiling all this data and getting this wonderful information, and you talk about it, and even before this, I'm sure, you sometimes have to share information about maybe a problem student's having with another person. Are there any privacy issues that kind of have a little bit of a, like, boy, now that we've got all this, we've got to be super careful with? Are there any areas that are making you more heightened about this information is great and having all this, but it does bump up the level of having to protect it at all? Or is it not that different than what you already?
Like Jen and I have, mastered ability or access. So the advisors are really kind of entering data and can track the number of students that are coming to their clubs and things like that. But in terms of like exporting the data and reading through the data and all of that, that's kind of at the,
Right.
And like even just something as simple as like Natalie, I'm like, hey, do you care if I pull you up on the screen in front of everybody?
Well, and I just want to note for the record, these two women are also very humble. They have taken time certainly to thank and congratulate the sponsors, but I want to make sure the community knows that both of these women have served in high leadership roles in the state activities organization. They have both served as presidents, correct? And they have been actively involved and are highly regarded by their colleagues. So we are very fortunate in this district to have two activity directors that can devote their time to this important part of student growth and development. So we want to take a minute, I think, and give you a round of applause on behalf of everyone and the two of you as well. Thank you.
All right, thank you very much. Next, adoption of the Certificate of 2014 Tax Levy and accompanying resolutions.
The process for the levy started sometime in April of 2014 when we started to discuss the amount of abatement, our fund balances, our tax rates, and the burden on our taxpayers. And through that process, we continued this discussion. And at the October board meeting, the Board of Education adopted the aggregate levy, which was in the amount of $71,460,000. The legal requirement is that the Board of Education adopt the aggregate levy and at least 20 days prior to the legal adoption of the levy, which you are hopefully going to do tonight. A couple of factors that are important to mention here is that at this time we do not know what our equalized assessment is going to be. That information comes out in March or April of 2015. What we do have is estimated numbers from the county clerk. And at this time, we project that we will see about 0.5% decrease in our equalized assessment. This is after about a $12 million increase due to new construction. And this is the smallest decrease that we have seen in the past few years. We have seen as high as 5%. But if you look at our equalized assessment, we are lower than what we were, I believe, in 2007 or 8. So we have lost a lot of value as far as properties are concerned in the district. And obviously that, as you know, under tax cap means that our tax rate goes up. We are bound by the Property Tax Limitation Act to the CPI, which is 1.5%. However, during our discussions with the board has once again decided to abate about $5.8 million of the bond and interest levy. This is in addition to the $6 million that has been abated in the past years, as well an additional abatement, which is new for the school district, of about $2.8 million from the operating funds. So what we are seeing is a decrease of our levy request. And if our extensions hold true, we'll see about a 9 to 10% less in property taxes than we collected in 2013-14. The taxes also that we received are received over a period of two fiscal years. So we'll receive some dollars in May and June, and about 50% or so in September and October. With That said, what you have in front of you is our levy request. We have a number of resolutions for you to adopt in relation to that, as well as a resolution authorizing the abatement of the bond and interest levy, which will be filed with the county clerk, hopefully this week sometime.
Okay, great. All right, so could I ask for a motion to approve the 2014 tax levy in the amount of $71,460, as well as the accompanying resolutions as listed on the agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Okay. Roll call.
Arthur?
Aye.
Batson?
Aye.
Deli Polly?
Nay.
Rudy?
Aye.
Lundstedt?
Aye.
Maurer?
Aye.
Ratzer?
Aye.
Okay, motion carries. Second, then, we need a separate resolution for the abatement of the bond and interest levy, correct? Okay, can I ask for a motion to abate the bond and interest levy?
I move to abate the bond and interest levy.
There a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Batson?
Aye.
Deli Polly?
Nay.
Grudy?
Aye.
Lundstedt?
Aye.
Maurer?
Aye.
Ratzer?
Aye.
Arthur?
Aye.
All right, motion carries. All right. Next, the superintendent.
Okay. Well, we're going to start with good news tonight, and school continues. We get more and more good news. First, the National Merit Scholarship Corporation has released the names of the 2015 commended students. The following 31 LHS and VHHS seniors have been recognized as scoring in the top 34,000 of 50,000 high scorers. And that is many millions of students that took the test, just so we have clarity on that. From LHS, Alaya Ani, Jonah Brame, Sean Bruno, Brent Cow, Rosanna Chen, Cameron Kuzmanko, Maya D'Souza, Sean Duffy, Samuel Gold, Laura Janicek, Benjamin Comers, Hannah Lampinen, Caitlin McKernan, Ava Polzin, Megan Kwan, Jane Recker, Pooja Sajiv, Haley Schuler, Ryan Tang, and from VHHS, Afreed Ahmed, John Brandel, Emma Ferguson, Grace Gao, Caitlin Grammons, Eric Hornstra, David Levering, Jessica Nee, Ariella Panos, Shubham Patel, Adam Weinberg, and Maria Yunovich. So congratulations to all those students. Congratulations to VHHS senior Kristen Guglemi on being named recipient of the DAR Good Citizen Award. The DAR Good Citizens Award and Scholarship Contest, created in 1934, is intended to encourage and reward the qualities of good citizenship. The award recognizes and rewards individuals who possess the qualities of dependability, service, leadership, and patriotism in their homes, schools, and communities. These students are selected by their teachers and peers because they demonstrate these qualities to an outstanding degree. So congratulations to Kristen. The following students were named LHS October Students of the Month: Anna Pearson, Kate Amuller, Anna Ferrugia, Haley Laska, Jessica Bringle, Clay Fife, Sheila Griffin, Charlie Murphy, and Ali Gatit. 78 District 128 student musicians were selected to the Illinois Music Educators Association District 7 Festivals, the highest individual honor that a high school musician can receive. Four VHHS students were selected among the best pit orchestras in the state. As a result, they will perform in the All-State Play Pippin January 8th through the 10th at the University of Illinois. These students are Scott Neer in percussion, Scott Bass, bass guitar, Sherry Lee, cello, and Kevin Bowes, violin. And last but not least tonight, LHS senior Ancor Rostogi, who I think we all know and is with us tonight. Raise your hand again, Ancor. Has just been named an intern in the Penwazi, how'd I do with that? It's pretty close. Health Careers Program at Advocate Condell Medical Center. The program provides an early opportunity for high school junior and senior students to learn firsthand about health-related careers. pronounced Penwazi, the name combines the three things a health professional always carries: a pen, a watch, and scissors. Penwazi has been an active student volunteer program at Condell Medical Center for over 50 years. So I think we can give you a round of applause, Ann Clark. Okay, next on the superintendent's report this evening, as you know, this time of year, we have received all of our student performance data from the year before, but I want to make a couple of comments as Rita makes her way up to the podium to review this for the public. As you know, the whole reason we do everything that we do is to ensure student growth and increase student achievement. And those two combining factors are what make excellent school districts. In the academic area, we monitor, in increasing student achievement, we monitor three major data points as well as information that's gathered at the curricular level, let's say math, English departments, and by individual teachers. And those are the Advanced Placement Program, the ACT Test Program, and the Illinois Prairie State Achievement Exam. By doing that, allows us to develop some longitudinal data and use data in driving our decision making for what has worked and what we need to continue to work on to ensure that all students grow and that all students achieve at higher levels. And we're happy to tell you, as we look over a 10-year profile, that we continue to build on the excellence of this district. And at the end of the day, we do not seek outside recognition in the district, but it is nice to be recognized from the outside for the work that our students have done at the point, our teachers and support staff and administrators have done with them at the building, and the board and district administration has done in creating an environment for all of that to happen. So tonight, we've asked Dr. Rita Fisher, who's our Assistant Superintendent for Curriculum Instruction, to highlight some of our assessment data in those areas. And we're very excited, again, to take a look at our achievement data. So, Rita.
Thank you, Prenna. There really is a clear connection between the student activities presentation that we saw earlier and the data we're going to reveal in regards to student achievement. These are external measures of how well we're preparing students for their next steps, for their post-secondary endeavors. And so when we look at state and nationally normed assessments, we see that the system of supports that we have in District 128, the involvement in student activities, the academic rigor of our programs, prepares students very well by any measure that we're going to examine. So the first set of data is in regards to our advanced placement program, and we're looking at growth in the program as well as increased achievement. Some of the most significant data, and this is this chart is not meant to be read in its entirety, but what it represents is the kind of growth and achievement in the district that few districts across the nation can point to. In 10 years, we've more than doubled the number of students who are experiencing rigorous advanced placement curriculum in District 128 classrooms. We've also more than doubled the number of total exams administered. And while doing that, we've ensured that 123% more exams are earning scores of 3, 4, and 5, which often earn placement and credit at universities across the country. We've also increased by 130% the scores of 4 and 5 on exams that are more readily accepted at some of the more selective institutions across the country. So the data shows that while we've dramatically increased participation in AP courses, the achievement that students have made has remained steady, and we've increasingly afforded to students the opportunity to enter college with college credit to their name. So the progress of growing AP programs and courses in the district has been one of steady increase. It's been one that's been recognized in the 4 years that the College Board has had an AP honor roll distinction, a district honor roll distinction. This will be the fourth, and that has not yet been announced, but the previous 3 years, District 128 has always been an AP district, has appeared on the district honor roll. And there are a very few select schools across the districts across the country who are on this honor roll. So every indication is that we're doing very well in our AP program, and that is due to the excellent staff that we have here, the support that we have for students to encourage them to attempt a rigorous curriculum and to help them succeed while they are in rigorous AP courses. The next set of data that we'll look at is in regards to ACT performance. The scores that we'll see for each for the district and for each school are graduating class of 2014 data. This includes the most recent ACT score that a student has taken. It sometimes is the best score, but not always. So it's the most recent ACT score, and that is used to compile averages for each for the district and for each school. Again, District 128 ranks among the top schools in the state and in the nation for ACT composite scores, with a district score of 25.3 composite for the graduating class of 2014. That score represents a statistically insignificant difference from the previous year. So we're holding steady and doing very well by all accounts in terms of ACT averages. With the state average at 20.7, the Libertyville High School composite score was a 25.6, again, well above state and national averages. The national average ACT is a bit higher. Illinois is one of the few states that offers the ACT to 100% of its students, and among the states that do that, among the 12 states, Illinois is ranked second in terms of the composite average. So the Illinois composite average is healthy for states across the nation. The District 128 average and each school's average is far above that state average. So our students are doing exceedingly well. Vernon Hills High School composite score of 24.7, again, far above the state average and consistent with its previous score. In addition, we look at Prairie State achievement exam data, and this will be the last year that we present Prairie State achievement data, as this is 2013 was the last year of the administration of the Prairie State exam. In spring of 2014 was the last year of PSAE data. In spring of 2015, the PARC exam will replace the PSAE as the state's accountability measure. Fittingly, District 128 Prairie State achievement performance composite was the highest it's ever been in 2014, with District 84.4% in reading, meeting or exceeding standards. And each school, again, showing in reading an increased performance from the previous year. So the 84.4 in reading is the highest district score, as is the 85.7 in math district-wide, meeting or exceeding standards, and the 84.2 in science, meeting or exceeding standards in 2014. That is the last slide in our PSAE achievement data.
Just Rita, thank you for tracking that data for us. And a couple of things just in perspective again, and Rita certainly hit these things, but just again for our community so they're aware. 10 years ago we started a journey, or 12 years ago, and Dave, former Superintendent Dave Clough, came to the district and began to review the advanced placement program and saw an opportunity to open doors for more students to take those classes by encouraging students to take those classes and providing necessary support for them to be successful. There was some wisdom in the field, and maybe at some schools there still is that wisdom. I think it's misplaced wisdom, that you limit honors programs to the students that you think can be honors kind of student material. And as a result of that, you keep your results high, because you have a very select, you have only the top students. And so what District 128 has demonstrated over the last 12 years, and certainly the last 10 years when we've been tracking data very heavily on this, as we've doubled the number of students, our pass rate at 3, 4, and 5 last year was actually higher than it's ever been. So by opening doors for more students to take those and encourage those students, giving them the confidence to take those classes, regardless of whether they even take the AP test, by taking that course, they're being exposed to a very rigorous curriculum. And the students that take the test at a very high rate here, and an increasing rate, are doing the best they've ever done in the history of this district. So that's one thing. The other journey is on ACT, and about 10 years ago, our average ACT composite in the district was in the upper 23s, which still would place us probably among the top 5% of high schools in the entire state, if not the country. Our composite is well into the 25s, and that's kind of a magic threshold for ACT, and LHS has been as high as 26 on the ACT as we work in bands from different classes. So again, you can see that growth over time. And as Rita pointed out, in the final year of Prairie State Achievement Exam, we have logged our highest scores in the history of that state test. So again, for us, it is all about continual improvement and ensuring student growth and increasing student achievement. And that's how we measure ourselves. And as a result, we have achieved much national recognition and much deserved national recognition over the past few years, and we will continue to do so in the public. But at the end of the day, that's not what it's about. It's about all of you doing better year over year over year. And that's what drives us. And that's what we work with the board on in terms of creating a framework and a structure for that to happen. District administrators working with our two outstanding principals at our buildings, who are the instructional leaders at their schools, working with the staff and the support staff and our communities as a whole to ensure that you are continuing to grow and you can achieve at higher levels. So I think we've got a very compelling story to tell, and we can tell that story because all of the pieces that need to be in place for public schools to be successful are in place here. And so we want to thank the students and the teachers and support staff and the administrators and the board and our communities for the support of this most unique school district that we have here, that we all think is a really great school district. So Rita, thank you for tracking that data. And certainly if the board has any questions, you can raise them. Or comments.
Okay, thanks.
I don't know if the students would like, if any of you would like to comment. You've talked a little bit about your preparation and your involvement in activities, but as you look back on your few years, whether you're a senior or you're a junior this year, and you look back at your time here, and we didn't really plan responses here, so any of you can just jump in, any or all of you can just jump in. If you reflect back on your time here and how that's helped you to grow as a student and academically, go ahead, take a shot at it.
Hi. Okay, so starting my freshman year, I started taking honors classes, and then I gradually increased my levels of honors and AP classes. So freshman year, I had a few honors. Sophomore year, I had like one honors and an AP, and as the years went on, I started taking on more AP classes because my teachers were the best support system that I could have possibly had, that were constantly motivating me to work harder and to be able to take on these challenging courses. And on top of that, I think it's also a matter of the peers that are involved in our classes. Like with my language arts / like English classes, these are the kids that we've been with since the first grade. Because in the first grade was the point in which they said, okay, you're a really good reader. Let's put you in this classroom with all these other good readers. And so these are the kids that I feel like I've been with for years, and I have no problem asking them for questions or asking them questions. And it's just a sense of comfortableness. And as we have more people added throughout the years who are being in these more challenging courses, we are always the ones to go to them if they have questions. Like, we're always there to help. And it's just the support system between our peers and our staff is just amazing. And there's nothing like it.
Yeah, I don't have too much else to say. Obviously, we're doing great, and that's great. The one thing that I would say in terms of AP classes is that every single teacher that I've had in an AP class has done a really great job of teaching the material and preparing us for the test, and I haven't had a problem with that. I haven't even had to study too much outside of doing the work required for each individual class. The ACT is really high stakes, I think, and so it's great that we're doing better, but in terms of getting into school, getting direct admission into certain schools, getting scholarships, it's really high stakes. So the one thing that I would say that I've noticed is that a lot of kids are going and hiring outside tutors and going to outside groups to help with that. I know we have a program at LHS that helps with tutoring and with getting those scores higher, but to the extent that we could increase participation in that, I think that would really help out a lot as well.
Others? Anybody else?
I'll take it.
Okay.
Just as far as the ACT goes, I know there's always a lot of focus on senior improvement, and one of the best ways to do that is standardization, and that comes in the form of AP exams, ACT tests, and we'd like to see those upward trends as far as all classes go. But I think the teachers and the administration doing a good job of making sure that we take things in context of what they are. They're good as metrics for looking at classes, and obviously they're very important individually. Once you get to a certain point, though, I think it becomes part of a larger package. So these tests are important, yes, but I think everybody that I've talked to as far as, you know, adults, people who go through this process with other kids, they do a good job making sure that we understand as students that, yes, it's important, but it's not going to be the sole deciding factor when they're either applying to college or for scholarships or et cetera. So I'm thankful for that context, because I've seen some kids stress out unnecessarily about it.
Sure.
John, do you have anything, any other comments that you want to make?
Well, I just think that the two presentation topics in combination are what makes this place special. I know you alluded to it, and several have jumped on that tonight, but to talk about the success of our activities and how it intertwines with success in other areas, including academics, I think is what really sets this apart. And I know, like Dr. Grudy said, he's got kids in the system, several of you do, I do, and the combination of those two things as a parent is something that I couldn't ask for more. As an administrator, watching all that you do in terms of how involved you are, and then continue to hit mark after mark, the context is amazing, the results are even more amazing.
Any other comments? Okay, thank you all. And Rita, thanks again to you. Jess, I would ask you at this time if you would give us an update on the Brainerd Building, Jackson Gym, asbestos containment and demolition. As we know it today, understanding that it could shift a bit tomorrow based on several factors.
Thank you, Dr. Lee. I bring you almost 100% good news.
Almost.
Can't get too high in this business. Our asbestos removal was supposed to have been completed last Friday. We did not achieve that goal because they found more tunnels and more asbestos as they went through the building. So they extended that till Wednesday. Mr. Stansel, you are confident that we will be okay by Wednesday, as what we know today. So that's good news. That will be completed and that will be done. In August, the Board of Education approved the bid for the demolition of the Brainerd Building at $484,800. We received or got the building back from the village in September, early September. Right after the board approved the bid to demolish the building, Rourke and Associates, the civil engineering firm that's used by our architect out of Naperville, proceeded to do all the paperwork necessary to get the building permit. And it's humongous, the amount of paperwork that has to be done. It was submitted to the village on the 16th of October. The village, to its credit, did a quick turnaround and lists Friday afternoon, we were in receipt of what other information they wished to us to provide. So as of this morning, if I was a betting man, and I'm not, I would have said that we are nowhere close to being ready to demolish the building in a week, 2 weeks, or 3 weeks. But as the day went by, lots of things fell into place. We have some issues still that need to be resolved, such as tree protection. The village is not clear if we're tearing down any trees, and if we aren't, how are we going to protect them? The silt fence that has to go around the property, they had questions of that. The need letters from Commonwealth Edison and North Shore Gas about the disconnecting of the utilities. North Shore Gas has been achieved. We're working on ComEd now. Then also, we needed a special insurance certificate naming everybody in the village, I think, as another insured. I'm being facetious, but it was voluminous, the amount of requirement that they needed on that. The other issue that is holding us up is we need to have a pre-construction meeting, again to the village's credit, instead of making this outfit come all the way from Michigan. They're letting us have a phone conference with all the parties to be. We are trying to get that set up for Wednesday or Thursday. With that being said, if everything that I've just said falls into place, it looks like next week we'll be able to start on the demolishing of the building. Monday, if everything would have been okay, would have been was the date we had targeted as the start date, would have been kind of too quick. They need time to mobilize and bring their equipment and set up and so forth. So as of today, I'm hoping that sometime next week, and I forgot, we also have to analyze, we got a change order for saving the parking lot at the east side of Brainerd, and that change order came into $90-some-hundred. We need to see how much it's gonna cost us when we do it ourselves, if we accept that in the spring. And those are the issues that we're facing with right now. So it could be worse. So I feel better than I did when I got up this morning. Any questions?
How long did they think it would take?
Oh, I wish I could answer that. I think it was 3 to 5 weeks. Chris, how long? 3 to 5 weeks or less?
What was the question?
Did they have an idea of how long?
It'll take about remove the building?
Yeah.
No more than 6 weeks, they said. There are some parts of the building that we're actually saving. Actually, a few parts of the building that we're actually saving for the dedication of the site itself. So those things are kind of delicate. So they say within 6 weeks the building should be down and secure and safe. Bill.
Thanks, Chris.
Thank you.
Okay. Is there any 6 weeks actually takes us into December? So are there any circumstances that might result in them not being able to finish?
No, sir. Once they get all the approval, no, sir. There.
Okay. And do we know the agenda for the phone call with the village this week? Is it a safety meeting or?
It's to go over all of the requirements that the village has, sort of the last minute requirements with the sidewalks and those kind of issues. You know, save the site and the time they're going to be working and so forth. Those kind of issues.
For those in the public, that we do have additional security on the premises from now until they actually start the demolition, I guess, right?
Yes, Dr. Lee approved security to, I guess there are two gentlemen, two-man team nightly protecting the building so that no one obviously climbs the fence and gets in there and, heaven forbid, would injure themselves. Especially with Halloween coming up, you know. If you remember, we declined an alternate to board up the building. It would have been a lot more costly than it is going to cost us to protect it with two gentlemen.
Any other questions on Brainerd? Okay, so when we get a date certain, obviously we'll let the board know. Mary's been... we have a section of the websites set up for Brainerd updates, much like we did with the swimming pool compliance. couple of years ago. So when there's an update, it goes on the site so people can follow that site as we get closer to that as well. We have three donation acknowledgments tonight. First of all, we'd like to acknowledge Mike Elkins from the Goodman Family Foundation. Yes, we're going back to Lancaster, Karen, because I already marked it off my agenda because I was going to do that next. So we'll come back to Lancaster. Thank you. Again, Mike Elkins from the Goodman Family Foundation. We want to acknowledge receipt of a $4,000 grant from the Goodman Family Foundation in support of the drug and alcohol prevention programs at Libertyville and Vernon Hills High School for the first semester of this year. We're very appreciative of that for our continuing work. Also to Mr. Craig Hunter, I want to acknowledge receipt of his donation of clothing to be used by the drama department at Libertyville High School. And we'll do a shameless plug for Spam-A-Lot now. That's coming up at Libertyville pretty soon. I'm sure the students are going to tell us about that. And also Jeff McClurg, president of LHS CATS. We want to acknowledge his receipt of a donation of $25,000 from Parent CATS for the Libertyville High School Cafeteria Courtyard Improvement Project. That was $25,000. Okay. So obviously a big thanks to them as well. And now back after we've built some suspense up to the Lancaster detachment petition. Just to bring the community up to speed very quickly, the board is aware and certainly the administration at the school, the Lancaster subdivision, which is at the north end of the district, is currently not in District 128 or Oak Grove 68, currently is in Warren Township High School district, and also Woodland Elementary District has been since the first house was built there. That community went through a legal process with the Lake County Board of Trustees to detach themselves from Woodland and Warren and come into Oak Grove and District 128. We and the three other districts involved opposed that detachment. We prevailed, I think, on a 6-1 vote at the Lake County Trustees after about seemingly many nights of hearings in that process, many more than they normally have. The Lancaster residents appealed that decision to the circuit court. The circuit court overturned the regional board. We appealed that to the appellate court. We recently received a decision at the appellate court has upheld the circuit court's decision, meaning that in the absence of any other legal intervention on July 1st, 2015, the Lancaster subdivision would detach from Woodland Elementary, Warren Township High School, and would come into Oak Grove District 68 and District 128. It's interesting that the appellate court ruled that they could not find an educational benefit for the students to come into our district, which is usually how those decisions are made. They veered off of what has been the traditional path of decision making there, and they also took things into account, such as the increased value of the homes of the detaching subdivision if they come into another school district. The danger here, of course, is not Lancaster. The danger is that the court, in making a ruling like that, and I sent something to the board today from several school legal firms that are now beginning to cite this case as a tremendous exception to the way the detachments are normally ruled. So what could ultimately happen is the courts are redrawing school district boundaries. Okay, so once you add a subdivision north, south, east, or west, then you've now made the district larger. And the contiguous districts, now you have a different set of neighborhoods that are closer to your district that can then detach and come into your school district, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So this goes way beyond the four districts involved in here with the nature of this decision. And talked with the board at the Facilities and Finance Committee meeting earlier in the month, and all four of the boards are in agreement that we will take this case to the Illinois Supreme Court. It's up to the Supreme Court whether they actually accept the case or not. There's about a 50-50 chance there. And if they do accept the case, then there's a 50-50 chance that they might rule in our favor, because the Supreme Court is not going to take a case that they already know the answer to, that's already been decided. So if we get into the court, we have a chance to prevail at that. And I think we had some very good conversation with the board about the merits of this. Our district, because of many of the things that we've talked about tonight, has been the subject of detachment petitions from around the district for a number of years, and likely will continue to be well into the future. But understand, as we gain students and property, other districts lose those students and that property value. And again, you are creating larger school districts and configuring the district differently by the court system in terms of doing that. So we will obviously keep the board and community apprised of that if we move forward, as we move forward. Also, the board will note that you have two FOIA requests this evening, which obviously we have and will comply with. And then three real quick hits under other tonight. First of all, we have developed a partnership with a very similar school in China over the last 8 or 10 years. And we have visited there twice. I think this was their second or third time coming over here, and they spent a little bit more than a week with us. There were several students and several faculty members and one of their administrators. The last time they came 2 years ago, they actually brought what would be their equivalent of a superintendent, who's also the provincial, in their system there is also the provincial Communist Party chief there. So has some decision-making authority with that. Karen was good enough to come over and meet with the students faculty and their administrators, and we had a nice 2-hour session with them. They spent the week visiting both schools and doing some other activities in the Chicago area and stayed with our families while they were here. As the board will recall, a year ago this past summer, after our last visit there, we had some conversation about wanting to extend that partnership with this school in China, and they have great interest in doing that. To the point that we talked about creating some one semester opportunities for our students to study. There they would be able to create a very unique experience for our students, including maybe some internships with some Chinese businesses while they are there. And in turn, their students could come over here and study for a semester, maybe do some teacher administrator exchanges. They have invited at their cost five of us to travel within the next 12 weeks or 12 months to China to return the visit to further map out some further steps that we might take toward this to move forward. We're very excited about doing that. That will likely be myself and Marina and John. We'd like a school board member to go with us if one of you were available to make that trip with us. We'd likely take a teacher with us, and then we have to have an interpreter, obviously. And we have someone that's worked with us at that group. So that is very, very exciting and really is a cutting edge possibility for us. But these are great people over there. And interestingly, they are taking a very strong look at many of the things that we talked about tonight, because they don't really have student activities per se. They don't have athletics, they don't have the fine arts that are necessarily attached to the school, and they notice a lot more engagement of the learner. It's a typical Asian model where it's instructor driven, and it's to prepare them for taking an all-important test at 2 or 3 different points, which will determine what high school they go to, will determine if they have the opportunity to go to college. This particular school is number 4 ranked in the entire country of China. And the way they establish that ranking in China is the number of students from their graduating class that get accepted at Beijing University, which is the Harvard of China. So it's a very high-performing school, but they're very interested in the Western or American model of education and the engagements of students. And the freedom, I think they kept using the word, the students and the teachers kept using the word, your students are freer in class, meaning that they interact with the instructor at a level that they don't do. So this is a really exciting possibility. So when we go over there, we'll have an opportunity to talk further about what that could look like. and then we'll come back and have some conversations with the board. Second, we've spent some time with the board talking about Senate Bill 16, which the public has read about a lot about in the news media, which would rework the funding formula for public schools in the state. We have great disparities in funding in the state, really based on what your zip code is. And whether you grow up in a rural town in southern Illinois or you happen to be in an area that's fairly middle class to affluent, like we live in this area of Lake County. The problem with the bill right now, as we've reported to the board in the past, is that there are too many large losing, particularly suburban districts, in the rebalancing of the funding formula. For example, District 128, under the most recent numbers, would lose $1.2 million a year. And when you multiply that times 10, okay, now we're looking at $12 million over a period of time. So that becomes a substantial amount of money. And so where districts who are desperate for funding and can't provide that locally would gain significant resources, it would, over the long haul, create the same kind of hardships with a number of other districts in the state. So we've been working with legislators over a long period of time to slow that train down. It was passed in the Senate last spring. It has to be passed in the House, and we got some good news this week. The chair of the House Elementary and Secondary Education Committee, Linda Chapalavia from Aurora, who's part of the Democratic leadership in the House, announced that the bill will not be called in veto session or the lame duck session before the new legislators are seated. And several folks that were initially proponents of the bill have now backed away from the bill when they've looked at the data to see how it would affect their local school district. So there's a need. The formula needs to be rebalanced. It needs to be tweaked more to avoid more losers in the district. So we'll continue to report to the board on that. And Pat, I think that includes probably my longest superintendent's report for a while. Okay.
All right.
Thanks.
Good. Okay. Now officially, the student school board reps. Who's going to go find out? You get up there and say
something. Oh yeah. Hello. So we have 35 students made the IMEA All-District Orchestra, which is also including Lynette and Natalie over here, so congrats to you guys. Our musical, Guys and Dolls, was actually having rehearsal right as we were walking in on this night. So that first performance is October 30th, and we'll be continuing through the rest of the week. Choir Fest is on November 5th, and our orchestra is finally preparing for their concert on November 18th. And as soon as that festival is over, band will begin preparing for their festival on November 8th. Athletic-wise, we have boys golf achieved 9th in state this past weekend, and both girls cross country and boys cross country will be attending sectionals this weekend. And sadly, our boys football team could not make it to the state playoffs. They lost this past game against Lake Zurich, which was a deciding factor. Unfortunately, we couldn't pull through. Student activities-wise, they're starting to plan the variety show, which is on December 4th, and there will be a guest appearance from a 17-year-old. We recently had our homecoming dance about 3 weeks ago. It was a great dance. I was there, and I know both of these ladies were there as well, and we had a great time. I know everyone else that was there had a great time as well. There was a much higher attendance percentage, which was a great success for student council. They did an excellent job at planning. Libertyville, you guys take it away.
As far as athletics go, Wildcat football did make it to the state playoffs this year. We'll have our first round versus Lincoln Park in a bit. Among other notable achievements, cross country competed both the IHSA conference and regional tournaments, and both girls and boys teams are moving on to the sectional race in Schaumburg this Saturday. Extracurriculars, as Dr. Lee points out earlier, our theater department is putting on a show of Monty Python's Spamalot, and that'll be going on November 6th, 7th, and 8th, so about a week and a half. You guys look forward to that. The annual Wish Fundraiser has begun, so Wish is a community-level charitable fundraising campaign Liberty Bowl runs every year. We have class coordinators that we organize as an entirety of the school. So that just started. We have our first informational meeting for leaders this Wednesday, and that'll be going on over the course of the next 2 months or so, up until around Christmas time. And then finally, for on the academic side of extracurriculars, our debate team had their first tournament of the year a few weeks ago at Schaumburg, and we placed very well. Our novices, who were the most kids to go because they were the PSAT happened to be on the same day, they did very well. Eric Chen actually received an honorable mention. And then finally, in terms of social and community issues, homecoming dance as well. Ours was about 2 weeks ago, October 11th, and it's getting better every year, and it's great to see both grow as an event and in terms of attendance. This year we had foosball, ping pong tables, and massage chairs in the portion of the cafeteria that was not allocated to water, and the portion of the gym that was not allocated to dancing. So a nice change, and it was fun to see. LHS held their annual CAD Tracks Career Fair this month, which represented some local national organizations as well as companies, and gave students a chance to explore potential career paths, things maybe outside of the traditional going, you know, for college and professional career. And then finally, upcoming events, we have the blood drive this Saturday, November 1st. So looking forward to that, nice chance to get back in more ways than just fundraising and academics.
Good job.
All right.
Now, invitation for public comment. Is there anybody from the public who would like to speak? And I remind you, we'd like to keep the comments to 3 minutes if we could, please.
Tim Anderson, 821 Bartlett Terrace, Libertyville. I'll refrain myself from saying I'm back. Some of you remember me from past school board days. The reason I wanted to address you was picking up on the demolition of Brainerd. Many years ago, and Jess can probably give me the date, when you created the new gym, you took all of the fill, in essence the clay out, and dumped it on an open gym field that was used for gym classes. It now sits there neatly sodded or neatly covered with grass, but it's still a giant hill that can't be used for anything. You even have signs asking the people not to get on the hill and play on the hill. So you gained a gym, but you lost an athletic site. Having walked the site many times before you put the fill in, it was large enough for a full competition lacrosse. If you moved a few, what I would deem junk evergreen trees and some shrubs, you could have had a full competition football field there. But you've lost that. My suggestion is you have an enormous need for parking. I'm sure you've had a lot of parents call you why we don't have parking. Last week for the Stevenson game, you had to bus people from the train station over because the Brainerd parking's been lost. So what I'm going to suggest is, as long as you're going to fill in the hole, why not use as much of that clay as you can to fill in the hole so that you can regain an athletic field right outside the doors of the school, one that you had before, regain that one, take that footprint of the two buildings that apparently you're just going to put gravel on for now, just put some simple blacktop on it and stripe it so the students and parents can have the parking that's so desperately needed. I know you have master plans of options because you made them available to us at the town hall meetings on the referendum issue of the Brainerd. So you have plans, phase 1, 2, 3, or 4, different options. But apparently you've not picked one. We knew that as soon as the referendum failed, you were getting the school back. What I'm suggesting now is you may want to accelerate how you wish to use that piece of property. It's going to be a big open space. The community is going to notice it. And if you have a whole footprint full of gravel that can't be used, you're liable to incite the village, especially the parents who have children with cars, that want to know why can't we park there. So I'm suggesting is you gain a win-win-win situation. The Presbyterian Church has recently torn down a house because they need more parking. The village is under pressure not to give the Presbyterian Church more demolition permits because the rest of the homes in the neighborhood that are not owned by the church do not want to have parking lots all around their house. So the village would like it if there was more parking for the Presbyterian Church. The Presbyterian Church would like it if there was more parking for the church. They want their parking on Sundays. You gain more parking during the week for the students by taking the open space you're going to have and just use it for parking. You can't leave just gravel because the first time you go to plow it, you're just going to be throwing gravel everywhere. So once you've got the gravel, some simple asphalt on it, stripe it, and solve the problem. The parents will be happy that you've given them parking. The church will be happy that you've given them parking. The village will be happy that you've given them parking. And the school will gain back an athletic field that literally was trashed and taken out by removing the clay and having an athletic field. It is a win-win-win situation. There's no downside, but it just has to be done now while you have the opportunity. If the contractors fill in with the fill that they have to bring in from outside, then it's going to cost you money to get rid of the clay later on when you should get rid of it anyway. That's just the suggestion. I hope you can act quick on it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Jerry Verbaden, 319 Carriage Hill Circle, Libertyville, Illinois. Yeah, every time I come here and listen to the presentations, I'm very, very, very happy to realize that as a community, we have an excellent education system, and I applaud you. I also applaud the work of both Dr. Lee and the staff when it came time to looking at the budgets, cutting some of the budgets, cutting expenses, and talking about the abatements. I'll believe them when I see them, and I'm hoping the hell they're coming. But my point now is I do have one other request. I've been to enough financial meetings or meetings, and I know that there was a talk of $125 to $130 million surplus. I know now that there are some abatements coming down the pipe. I have seen some cost cutting on the new budget being submitted. But what I'd like to see now is I'd like to see a projection over the next 5 years, what it would be, that would basically show with the abatements coming back to the taxpayer, you're giving back the money, okay, what is it gonna be when that occurs? When are we gonna be at a level of surplus that is agreed upon by everybody that's realistic? $125 to $130 million surplus is not. I applaud the abatements that I've seen to look at, but it's still like a pimple on the elephant's you-know-what. So I'd like to see more. I'd also like to see the projections on what's to come. And where do we settle in on? How do we measure, how do we manage to a realistic surplus as we go forward and not hurt the taxpayer in collecting excess of funds? One other thing that I would like to request, you know, I saw an awful lot of good things today, tonight, and I'm looking at that and I'm saying, boy, if I'm a new family coming into either Libertyville or Vernon Hills, how do I justify the amount of taxes that I'm paying? Okay, you've got a very marketable product here that should be bound, put together, and given to those people that show and display what your achievements have been academically. Do we have it? I don't know, but if we don't have it, boy, I sure think we need it. Okay. Thank you.
Good comment. Thanks. Anybody else? Okay. All right. Next, the consent vote agenda is listed. It was reviewed earlier this month in committee. If I could ask for a motion, please, to approve the consent vote agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Deli Polly?
Aye.
Grudy?
Aye.
Lundstedt?
Aye.
Maurer?
Aye.
Ratzer?
Aye.
Arthur?
Aye.
Batson?
Aye.
All right, motion carries. Program and Personnel Committee, Chairperson Maurer.
Okay. We have a number of board policies, 7 in all, that we're going to put forward for first reading. First, we have Board Policy 220, Powers and Duties of School Board, Indemnification. This primarily removes indemnification from board powers and duties and adds a paragraph on indemnification. Then have policy 460, purchases and contracts. It adds conditions to contractors before working with school districts, including fingerprinting, restrictions on working around students, and medical requirements. We are already doing this and have been doing this for quite some time, but we're merely updating our paperwork to show that. Then there's personnel policy 530, hiring process and criteria. This removes the requirement for TB testing when hiring new employees. Physical exams, however, are still required. Then we have personnel policy 5260, student teachers, and it clarifies that no one may be hired as a student teacher. Actually, they're not hired, they're just accepted as student teachers, who has been convicted of certain criminal offenses that are listed in the school code. Now, we've already been doing that for a number of years, but again, we're just updating our paperwork to go with that. Then we have students policy 720, harassment of students prohibited. It adds protected status from bullying to national origin, military status, and unfavorable discharge status from military service. Then we move to policy 7180, prevention of and response to bullying, intimidation, and harassment. And there are significant changes to respond to legislation passed, including changes to the bullying prevention policy and added provisions for cyberbullying. I believe we already do a really good job with this, too. Policy 7240, conduct code for participant in extracurricular activities. It just adds language on performance-enhancing drug testing, that the state is able to do it should they so desire, not necessarily our district. Any questions on any of those? Or anyone need further clarification? Otherwise, we'll present them again next month for adoption. Okay, then next on the agenda, we have educational tool requests, and there are 15 of them. So we need a motion to accept those 15 trips.
So moved.
Bunstead?
Aye.
Nauer?
Aye.
Ratzer?
Aye.
Arthur?
Aye.
Abson?
Aye.
Dellipalli?
Aye.
Grudy?
Aye.
Okay, motion carries. Finally, employment of employees. We have one certified staff replacement hire. So we need a motion to approve that hire.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Nauer?
Aye.
Ratzer?
Aye.
Arthur?
Aye.
Abson?
Aye.
Dellipalli?
Aye.
Grudy?
Aye.
Lundstedt?
Aye.
Okay, and that concludes the report.
Thank you. Facilities and Finance Chairman Batson.
Thank you, Dr. Grudy. We have two items. Both are bid awards. The first one is at Libertyville High School, the exterior temperature pipe bid. Jess, do you have any additional information you want to share?
Yeah, this started back in December when Chris, Mark, and Alex were meeting with our architect and our mechanical engineer about the new heating plant that we were putting in, and it was discussed, would it be all right if we, or would it be a good idea if we move our pipe above ground and over instead of burying the pipe like happened to us in December when we had the leak and all kinds of heck broke loose at old LHS. So we did recommend that we do this. The bids came in, $293,000 from Amber Mechanical out of Elsip, Illinois. That number includes $40,000 in allowance, which means that nothing goes wrong and that we don't have an unforeseen situation happen, we get keep the $40,000 and come back to us. So it's a good bid, and it was in within the estimate, and we'd like you to approve that. Okay.
Thank you. We have a motion. A second, please.
Accept the bid. Yes, Jess.
Second.
Any discussion? Comments? We have a roll call.
Ratzer?
Aye.
Arthur?
Aye.
Abson?
Aye.
Dellipalli?
Aye.
Grudy?
Aye.
Lundstedt?
Aye.
Mauer?
Aye.
Okay, motion passes. The second bid recommendation is for two student activity buses.
We received three responses for our bid for two activity buses, one for each building. We're recommending tonight that the bid be awarded to Southern Mobility for two 2015-DH416 buses. We're also going to be trading in two of our older buses, so the net cost of the bid is $79,820.
Okay. We have a motion and a second.
I make a motion that we accept the bid from Southern Mobility.
Second.
Any discussion, question? Okay, roll call, please.
Arthur.
Aye.
Abson.
Aye.
Dellipalli.
Aye.
Grudy.
Aye.
Lundstedt.
Aye.
Mauer.
Aye.
Ratzer.
Aye.
Motion passes. That concludes facilities and finance.
One other. So with respect to Brainerd, I mean, we expect to hit that in earnest in spring, right, as far as?
Yes.
And we pretty much decided on
green space, reconfiguration of existing parking. If you think about Brainerd as a rectangle, the parking would go down the backside. Plans are for a permanent storage facility out there for equipment, two permanent washrooms to replace the portable toilets that Bryant needs to have out there several times a year, and the balance of the property will be green space for student use.
Okay.
So
and the gazebo.
And the gazebo or a remembrance on a corner of the property for the building.
All right, no property, no CEDAW, no Illinois Association of School Boards. Motion adjourned.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Good night, everybody.